My task in this segment is not to talk very much about the actual forms of relief, but basically, especially for the newer practitioners, to just talk about what immigration court is like, what's going to happen, what are the hearings like, how it may be similar or different to other types of court processes or administrative processes that you might be familiar with. So let's start there. First of all, who are the players? It's kind of complicated if you're not used to this entire immigration scheme to figure out who are those that you're going to be dealing with in this process. So I just want to start here. Many people who have heard for years about INS may think or may recall that all of the immigration functions used to be under one agency. INS was, as my kids used to say back in the olden days when you were alive, all of INS was within the Department of Justice, and so all of the players basically in the immigration system were there. That's no longer the case. After the 9/11 attacks, Department of Homeland Security was created, INS was abolished, and Homeland Security and Department of Justice were separated. So what you have now, as you see here, the Department of Justice contains, of course, among many other justice agencies, the Executive Office for Immigration Review, and the Executive Office for Immigration Review contains the two primary immigration court agencies. One is the immigration courts. Those are the trial level courts that are all over the country, and those are the ones that actually adjudicate in the first instance, courts of initial jurisdiction for children and adults in immigration proceedings. And then the next level, but still within EOIR, is the Board of Immigration Appeals. There's only one Board of Immigration Appeals. It's in Falls Church, Virginia, and that's the body that hears all the appeals nationwide from immigration courts all over the country. So think about immigration courts and the BIA, both within EOIR, and that all within the larger Department of Justice. Then another agency that's involved is the Department of Homeland Security. Meredith mentioned earlier CBP, Customs and Border Protection. They're part of DHS, and they're the ones that apprehend the children in the first instance and turn them over for care and custody purposes to the Office of Refugee Resettlement in DHHS that you heard about. But you're by and large not dealing with ORR in terms of prosecution of the children's cases in the immigration court. There you're going to deal with immigration and customs enforcement. The body within DHS that's charged with prosecuting removal proceedings, again for adults and children, is what's known as ICE. Those are commonly called trial attorneys. Those are your, in technical terms, your adversaries in the immigration court. At times they're your friends. They're the ones that with whom you will try to work out motions, stipulations, sometimes agreement to relief on the merits, but in the technical sense, they're the prosecutors in immigration court, and you representing the child respondent are the equivalent of defense counsel. The next agency still within Homeland Security is U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services. You may have nothing to do with USCIS at all, depending on the type of relief your child is going to be pursuing. But if you are going to be seeking asylum on behalf of your child client, jurisdiction over those claims to begin with, although you start out in the immigration court, the first adjudication is going to be in the asylum office of USCIS, so you have to be aware of that agency. And also, if you're pursuing special immigrant juvenile relief, which you'll hear more about later in the presentation, there's a part of that type of relief that also requires adjudication of a visa petition by USCIS. So they're not present in the courtroom, but they are involved in some of the case types that we'll be talking about. I've also listed state court in special immigrant juvenile cases. Again, not in the immigration courtroom, nothing you need to deal with in the immigration court proceeding, but you have to be aware of them as a player, particularly if you have an SIJS case. And the other two main players, the respondent, that's the terminology used for the person who is responding to charges of removability. Again, adult or child in immigration court is called the respondent, and you, the child's lawyer. We don't have the picture here, but there's one that there's a picture that's in a lot of immigration training materials, and I think KIND uses it a lot. There's a picture of a courtroom, and you use it in the context of telling the kid what's going to happen. And there's up here el juez, you know, the judge in the front of the courtroom. And then there's el fiscal, el gobierno, okay, the government prosecutor here. And then there's, at the other table, there's su abogado, right, the lawyer and you. And the thing that I think about when I see that picture is, what if the abogado isn't in the picture? Imagine what that picture is for the kid, right? The judge, the prosecutor, and the table where the kid is sitting by himself. And we think about the kid with the little feet dangling, you know, trying to respond to the charges. So I can't emphasize enough how important is the you in this respondent and you as a main player. Here on this slide, I have just some important resources for you in figuring out what's going on if you're trying to first get oriented to immigration court proceedings. The telephone number on here is the immigration court automated hotline that you can always call if you haven't received a hearing notice or your child has moved from one jurisdiction to another. This telephone number is a number that you can call to find out when hearings are scheduled. Now, in many places for juveniles, that information won't actually be on there, and you have to call the clerk's office for the court. Actually, for juveniles, it's not supposed to be on there, but I put it here nevertheless because sometimes they make a mistake, and it actually will be available there. But if it says no information is available on your case, that means they've actually gotten it right, and you need to call the clerk's office in the individual for whichever jurisdiction you're in. Who's representing DHS? This link will take you to a chart that shows you where all the various trial attorneys' offices are located. So you click on the one for the jurisdiction in which you're appearing, and that'll give you the contact information for the Office of Chief Counsel in that jurisdiction. The last thing on here, the Immigration Court Practice Manual. This is the most important resource, I think, that I can probably mention. It's really designed for pro se people as well as lawyers, and I'm not usually a great lover of government resources in telling people how to represent themselves, but this one I have to say is fairly newly created, and it's quite good. And the FAQ section in the back is designed for pro se people, so it's in simple language, easy to understand, with questions that newer practitioners would also come up against. So take note of the Immigration Court Practice Manual. Okay, so removal proceedings for minors. There are two sections of the Immigration and Nationality Act, which is the principal statute that's involved in removal proceedings. You see here a reference to INA 240. 240 is so-called full removal proceedings, where the respondent has a right to a wide range of forms of relief. Expedited removal proceedings underneath, under 235B, those are very very limited and apply before somebody has expressed a fear of return. Now, the children, by definition, if you're getting children in removal proceedings, they're in full 240 removal proceedings. And you are hearing, in the context of this training, a lot of talk about expedited hearings, expedited hearing dates. But what I want to convey is those are not expedited removal proceedings. Kids in immigration court are in full 240 removal proceedings, and they are eligible for a wide range of forms of relief. The last bullet that I have here is the point I was making before. Asylum claims, very recently under the Trafficking Victims Reauthorization Act, are children's asylum claims are heard, even though they're in removal proceedings and are technically before the immigration judge, they have the opportunity to present their claim for the first time before an asylum officer. It's a one-on-one interview across a desk in a setting that's supposed to be non-adversarial. There's no prosecutor. There's no cross-examination in that sense. It's a more child-friendly process, and in general is much easier for the children to go through. So the child is still in removal proceedings, but they'll file their asylum application. They'll get scheduled for an interview before the asylum office. The asylum office does have jurisdiction to grant asylum, but if they do not, the case will be referred back to the immigration court, where there's the opportunity for a hearing de novo before the immigration judge. So you may have an asylum hearing before the immigration judge, but always in the first instance before an asylum officer. Okay, charges and placement in removal proceedings. This is a bit about the notice to appear. Notice to appear is the name of the charging document in removal proceedings. Is there one in the materials, Meredith? Did we put an NTA?
I don't think so.
Okay. There might be one in the KIND manual that's linked to, or any of us can show you, but
we can put one up.
It's also it's available on the website of ICE that we mentioned too. The NTA is the charging document that says what are the charges of removability against the respondent. It basically has typically four sentences. It'll say you're not a citizen of the United States, you are a native and citizen of such and such other country, you entered at a time and place, you know, known or unknown as the case may be, you know, near Laredo, Texas, or, you know, in some other location. You didn't have, in kids' cases, it's frequently, and you didn't have permission to enter. You didn't have a proper entry document. We'll talk about hearings in a minute, but the point of the notice to appear is it has to set forth what are the factual allegations that the government is making about the respondent, and what are the violations of law that the child is charged with. Who can serve the NTA? There are very specific limited government officials that are allowed to sign the NTA. Customs and Border Protection officers fall within that category, and in the kids' cases, they're usually the ones that have signed them. Frequently, their names and titles are typed on the NTA, but sometimes it's a big scribble. You can't even tell who signed it or what it says. So I mention that here to be sure to take a look at that, because one of the ways, and we'll see it in a moment, one of the ways to defeat a notice to appear and then removal proceedings is if the NTA has not been properly prepared and served. When do proceedings commence? You'll often see there's a notice to appear that's been signed by an immigration official and served on the child, and the child may have even signed for receipt of it, so you think that proceedings have commenced, but they have not. The removal proceedings don't actually commence until that notice to appear is filed with an immigration court that has jurisdiction over the child. So in the children's cases, because this reunification process is going on, and right now is going on fairly rapidly, often what the kids get is a notice at the bottom that says their hearing is before a court TBD at a time and place TBD to be determined. So you don't even know what court has jurisdiction, and frequently the NTA hasn't been filed. And often what happens after the child is reunified and moves to Baltimore or New York or whatever it is, then ICE actually lodges the NTA with the court, and that's the time at which the proceedings actually commence, when the NTA is lodged with the relevant immigration court. Okay, so notice to appear, what does it have to do? And these are set out again so that you have a chance to analyze whether the NTA is deficient. It has to tell the nature of the proceedings. Your respondent is under removal proceedings under whatever provision of the INA. What have they done? Again, these are the factual allegations or conduct that's in violation of law. what statute are they alleged to have violated. There must be a provision on there, and this is a printed form, so this is normally on there, that they have a right to be represented in immigration proceedings as long as it's at no expense to the government. So that means if they're lucky enough to have been connected with you, they have a right to be represented by you. And a notice of the obligation to notify the court if they move or otherwise change their address. Okay, so there are two there's really three, but there's not bond for children. So we're gonna talk here about the two types of hearings in immigration court. One is called a master calendar hearing and the other is called an individual or a merits hearing. While I'm saying there are two types, there may be more than one instance of each type. Master calendar hearing is just what it sounds like. It's a calendaring hearing. It's fast, it's quick, it's preliminary. Master calendar hearings frequently only take 5 or 10 minutes, especially with experienced lawyers that understand what's going to happen and can go through the questions that the judge is going to ask fairly quickly. I don't like this comparison to a criminal arraignment because these are civil proceedings. They're not criminal, but by way of analogy, it's probably the best one there is if you're familiar with that type of short scheduling hearing. The thing that also happens at a master calendar hearing is the respondent, in this case your child client, has a chance to plead. Is obligated to plead to all of the allegations and the charges of removability on the notice to appear. And pleading means admit or deny each of the allegations. The client is not obligated to admit any of them, although if they're absolutely true and you're sure that they're true and you're ready to go forward, then I don't generally counsel denying just for the sake of denying, but often you're not sure at the first master calendar whether they're true or not true, or sometimes they're partly true and partly not true. Like you entered the United States on such and such a date and the date is wrong, or you entered at such and such a place on such and such a date and the date may be right, but the place may be wrong, whatever. It's also possible to partially admit and partially deny, but of course don't ever admit anything that's not fully true. And then you can, at the end of a master calendar, ask for a continuance. You can ask for a continuance to plead if you need to do a better investigation, more interviewing of your client to even figure out what your pleadings should be or what applications for relief you may be intending to file. And you can also just ask for the next master calendar after you've pled to come in and file whatever application for relief. The judge will give you time between the first master. You'll get additional time to prepare whatever application you need, but that filing is done at a subsequent master calendar hearing. And at that next master, that's where you will, at whatever master you're actually filing your application, that's when you'll be scheduling your case for the hearing on the merits. So those are all the things that happen at a master. Individual hearing is the trial on the merits. Some are longer, some are shorter. It depends on how involved, how detailed, how many witnesses, how many documents, whether you need an interpreter or not. I've said that an individual hearing is usually 2 to 4 hours. When you're doing your master and the judge asks you how much time you need, I think there's frequently pushback if you say you need more than 4 hours. But if you anticipate a number of witnesses or the need for one or more experts and you can tell the judge why you think you need more time, go ahead and ask for it and make your record. An important thing, I think, is not to be intimidated by the judge and the that sort of sense that the train is moving, you know, and they want to go quickly, and the judge may tell you, sorry, I only have 90 minutes and that's the best I can do. If you think you can't put on your case in that amount of time, you have to say that on the record so that you're preserving any due process issues if you're not given the time you need to fully present your case. But I would say 2 to 4 hours is, on a merits is, in a contested matter, is pretty typical. The decision also normally happens at the individual hearing. This is a place that people are frequently surprised to find out that the judge in removal proceedings usually renders an oral decision from the bench at the end of the hearing. There is not normally a written decision other than a transcript of that oral decision that's generated if there's an appeal. So when the child asks you in advance, what's going to happen at the end, when do we know? Usually you know the decision at the end of that merits hearing. If the judge doesn't have time to render the oral decision, if there are complicated issues, if research is necessary, the judge may reset the case for another day to deliver an oral decision, or may tell you that the decision will be mailed out. Either of those things are possible, but I would say it's 10% or less of the cases, especially for the kids, that you get a written decision. Okay, now how do you go about doing this? What do you need to go into immigration court? You must enter your appearance in the court on a form file called EOIR 28. Those of you that have appeared will be familiar with that. Right now, there are no limited appearances permitted, although in some parts of the country, the judges will allow a person to enter only for a master calendar, only for purposes of pleading. But you must assume, unless you know local practice to be different, that when you file your E-28, that is your entry of appearance with the court, and you are in the case for the duration unless you get permission to get out. So it's not, you're not entering just for the day. Is the E-28 in the materials?
No.
Okay. So we'll add that to the list of things that will make a sample, but again, that's on the website of EOIR. And attached to the practice manual, so it's very easy to find. For children who are going to be seeking asylum, as I said, you'll be going to the first interview in the asylum office. And for that, you need a separate form, G-28, to appear before the asylum office itself. It's a very similar form, looks almost identical, but you have to go for that because you're in the asylum office. Okay, the next thing I have up here is reviewing and obtaining a copy of the files. Sometimes with children this isn't necessary. Sometimes you will get a record that's very good and very clear about everything that's happened with your child and in the case before they've come to you. But sometimes they may have been bounced around. They may have had a master calendar hearing or more than one before another court, before they got reunified. Frequently, the children are not able to relay to you a very good history of exactly what happened. If you ask them whether they've pled to the NTA, I guarantee you they're going to have no idea. So sometimes it's important for you to actually, before you take any action, see what's happened before. You can go to the immigration court with jurisdiction over the case and show a copy of your E-28, and you will be allowed to review the file. If you are considering taking the case but you haven't made a commitment to do it yet, the courts have a form that you can get your client to sign that it's a Privacy Act waiver, basically, and gives you the right to take a look at the case for purposes of evaluating possible representation. Also, there are tapes or digital recordings of prior proceedings that you can listen to under the same process. You make arrangements for that with the court clerk. And you can get a limited number of pages of documents copied. If you're coming in the case very early, it'll be enough, because I think it's 20 pages or something like that that they'll copy for you. And very early on in the proceeding, there's not usually much that's happened. But at least you can get a look at the NTA. You can see if anything has been filed in the case already. Separately, you may want to do a Freedom of Information Act request, and this slide just tells you how to go about doing that. That'll show you what statements may have been taken from the child at the border, what the CBP officer said about your child and whomever he or she was traveling with. Often there's some kind of statement in there that the child says they were coming to work, and that's because the CBP said, you're just coming to work, aren't you? And in that desire to please that you heard about. They're just saying, mm-hmm, and you'll see that. And you can, for someone in removal proceedings, get expedited processing of a FOIA request, and you should request that. Okay, so a little more detail now on a master calendar hearing, exactly what happens when you're there. The judge, of course, will ask the parties to identify themselves for the record, so the trial attorney will identify him or herself, and then you identify yourself as the lawyer for the child. You'll be asked first. Oh, and then the judge will ask the child, like, is this your lawyer? Do you agree that he or she can represent you? The next thing is that there is a formal reading of the charges on the NTA. You have the right to waive that if you like, so that you don't need to spend time reading that out loud. Pleadings, as I indicated, the judge will go through each one of those allegations. How do you plead to allegation number one, number two, number three? And you can say, we admit 1 to 3, deny number 4, whatever it is that you have to say or do. But you'll go through those one by one. And I should say that in not all, but many of the courts, they actually have a script for pleadings taped to the table so that if you are unfamiliar with this process, you should be prepared. In Baltimore, they do tape it. So if you're new, you should know and expect the things that are going to come up, but they'll actually have a thing. So you can say, Your Honor, we acknowledge proper service of the notice to appear and waive reading of the NTA. We admit 1 and 2, deny 3 and 4, and it's right there for you. But I can't promise that everywhere, but in some places. You will be asked to designate the type of relief for which you're going to apply. So as I said, if you're ready to identify relief, we're going to be applying for asylum, Your Honor, or special immigrant juvenile status. You can do that. If you're not ready, you say you need more time to identify relief and ask for a second master. You will be asked to designate the country for removal if removal is ordered at the end of the case. If there's the slightest chance that your child is going to be applying for asylum, don't designate the home country. You can decline to designate, and often that's a prudent thing to do if asylum is an issue. The judge will ask the trial attorney what country they think is the country of nationality to which the child should be removed. Usually the judge will order the country that the ICE attorney identifies anyway, but if the real significance of this is if your client potentially has claim to status in some other country, let's say the parents are from two different countries or the child is a dual national, they may want to designate the other country. But in most of the cases, that's not a factor. You'll be told, as part of the pleadings, you're asked about filing dates, any filing issues, any problems with any of the evidence that's in the case. Oh, it also, sometimes it comes up they're using the wrong name for your child or your child entered with an alias, carrying someone else's document. This will be a place to clear up what the proper name should be. And there are advisals given that actually the judge is the one that gives the advisals, warnings for filing a frivolous asylum application, the obligation to show up for all the hearings, telling the child they can be deported if they don't appear for any hearing, the right to counsel, those steps have to be given. The bullet I have here, don't skip over analyzing any of the steps, that's on pleadings. I really urge practitioners to think carefully about each one of the allegations. And again, I don't fight for the sake of fighting, but think carefully about whether you want to admit them or not. And don't just do it because it's easier or because the judge may be pressuring you to do that. And know when you go into the master what you're going to do on each of those things. And at the end, whether you want to be scheduling or whether you're seeking another continuance and for what reason. And how long you need. Be ready to tell the judge, do you need 2 weeks? Do you need 60 days? Don't go to a master calendar and be on the record like, oh, well, Your Honor, I don't know. Remember, court time is at a premium. They want to move it along. Feel free to ask for what you want, but know what that is before you get in the courtroom. Okay. I want to hurry up. The main point about the questions for removal proceedings and for pleadings is don't skip over thinking about whether there's any chance your child is a U.S. citizen. A U.S. citizen is not subject to removal. If you're not an alien under the terms of the statute, you can't get removed. And so I have a lot of material in these slides about figuring out whether your child might be a U.S. citizen or not. We've talked pretty much about the main forms of relief. Asylum and SIJS, followed by adjustment of status, are the main ones we're going to talk about. Voluntary departure is technically not available to people who have not been in the country for a year or more before served with the NTA, but I know that in some parts of the country it's common practice to give voluntary departure to children. Prosecutorial discretion, basically. If your kid does not qualify for any form of relief from removal, but there are some serious equities, maybe they're taking care of a very ill parent, maybe they have a child of their own who has special medical needs in the U.S. I don't know what. I could make a list 20 things long. But if there is some valid reason where you think your child is not going to qualify for relief, but the individual specific facts or the case are so serious that the child should not and likely would not be removed, that is something you should be raising with the trial attorneys and asking them just not to pursue the case. If that happens, you'll get termination or at least a long-term administrative closure, and there won't be a trial. These are few and far between, but you should know that it's a possibility. Okay, individual hearing, trial on the merits. Think about any case, any kind of trial or court case that you ever knew about. The structure is very much the same. The government has the burden of proof on proving removability, and you have the burden of proof on whatever form or forms of relief you're seeking. So in that sense, it's like whatever else you've done. But I'm going to go through and highlight some of the things that are the same, some of the things that are different. Opening statements are very rarely permitted in immigration court. Every once in a while, a judge will indulge a new practitioner, or if it's hard to figure out what the case is about or what the issues really are, the judge may ask you. Normally, you don't need an opening statement because you have an application for relief. It's clear what you're seeking, and the judge want to be call your first witness and let's get going. So I think it's a good idea to have one prepared, or if you want to highlight one specific issue. Your Honor, this is a particular social group case, or Your Honor, this you know, involves whether a certain some kind of criminal charge is or isn't a bar to asylum. You may want to focus on that, but in general, the judge doesn't want to hear a big long opening statement telling them the law they already know. So most of the case will be focused on your case in chief. The respondent, your client, almost always has to testify first. It's very rare when the judges will allow another witness to testify first, but I would say if there are psychological or mental health conditions that the judge needs to know about, especially if they're supported by a written report, the judge may hear from that witness first to help them understand how to question or interpret the testimony of the child. Occasionally there'll be an expert witness that's out of town in a different time zone, needs to testify by phone because they're, you know, otherwise going to be at a UNHCR hearing. For some serious reasons, some other witness may be able to go first, but it's not like a regular civil case where you can do whatever order you want. Cross-examination happens after each witness, after your direct examination. Frequently, the immigration judge's cross-examination is more substantial than the cross-examination of the ICE trial attorney because usually they just read the file that morning before they went into the courtroom and they haven't had as much time to prepare as the judge has. Usually the judge has read your submissions ahead of time and is more focused. Also, another thing that practitioners are somewhat surprised by, and it's a good idea to prepare your client about, is the judge can interrupt your questioning and take over the direct at any time. The judge can inject questions of his or her own, can move right up to basically the ultimate issue. If the judge gets an idea, they know where you're going, they'll be like, stop. And especially if you're going what the judge perceives to be too slow. So you tell the child, the judge may ask questions and that doesn't mean anything is wrong. So other witnesses, if you have them, cross-examination too. Proffers, this comes up if there are, if you're lucky enough to have several witnesses and some of them may be perceived to be cumulative, or if you want to call witnesses by telephone and the judge doesn't want to, you can give a proffer about what the testimony would be. And the judge may accept that or may decide then to let you call them or whatever, but be prepared with proffers on any witnesses that may be questionable. The government's witnesses come after yours. Usually there aren't any. The government's case is usually cross-examination and closing argument. Closing, as I said, typically is allowed, especially for you. Decision, usually oral, maybe written. And an important thing to know, once the decision is rendered, both sides have the opportunity to waive appeal or reserve appeal at that moment. So you need to be prepared to reserve or not. If the decision is not fully favorable, I would normally reserve so you have time to talk over with your child client what they want to do. Sometimes they want to give up and waive on the spot, and I've had that unfortunate call, you know, the next day where they change their mind, and then you're in the position of seeking to reopen the case. So I try not to do that. Burdens of proof, I've said this, you have the burden on relief. Practice tips very quickly. Know the statute, the regulations, and the case law. This is pretty much in your materials, and we'll cover it a bit on the substantive forms of relief. The immigration court is controlled by the precedential decisions of the BIA, as I said, within EOIR, and then by the Federal Circuit Court of Appeals in which the immigration court sits. So if you're in Arizona, it's really good to know the Ninth Circuit law. If you're here, the immigration judges in this jurisdiction do not want to hear about Ninth Circuit cases, okay? They're persuasive at best, but you really need to know which geographic circuit governs your proceedings, and that's the law on which you should be relying. Follow the immigration court practice manual. It has really petty things about two-hole punching and where the tabs can be. Make sure you do it right or your filing will be rejected and you may be out of time on something. Credibility is super key. We'll talk more about that on substantive relief. And read all of the documents. Whatever you're submitting, read the whole thing. Don't put in some article that has one line that helps you without reading it all, where it has a paragraph on page 32 that completely ruins some other aspect of your claim. If you want the judge to read it and rely on it, make sure you do too. Motions, there are some that are permitted. The main thing is to, the practice manual governs the style of them, so make sure you follow the right style. Try to get consent for them if you can, and indicate to the court if these motions are by consent. Rules of evidence do not apply. You may be familiar with the federal rules and your local rules of evidence. They don't apply, but the spirit of them really does apply. You can use case law under the federal rules by analogy. The biggest distinction is that hearsay, by definition, people are talking about things that happened in other countries, what people said about their motivation, threats, whatever, that aren't there. So hearsay is expressly permitted, and the other rules of evidence are, you know, generally looked to as a guide. Due process and fairness is the judge's main lodestar, let's say, touchstone. Standard objections, these are very similar to the ones that you would hear in any other court. And for children particularly, think about things like foundation, harassing, asked and answered. You'll see a pretty extensive list. Experts, I'll say, people always say, well, do I need one? How many do I need? You don't always need them, but they can be very helpful. It depends on what your case is about. If you have a gang issue and it's an obscure gang, you might want an expert. If your child is very unable to testify because of some serious trauma, you might want a psychological expert. If there are there's discrimination against a particular religion or a particular ethnic group that's not very well known, an expert on that might be helpful. This is not a child case, but I saw a case from India recently where the respondent was talking about being a member of a scheduled caste, and the judge was asking a lot of questions about the schedule, didn't understand that scheduled caste meant untouchable. The judge was like, well, where can I get the schedule? And what? And it is such a disconnect. So that might not be the greatest example, but depending on what your case was about, you may actually want somebody to spell it out for the judge. And if you are going to want to use an expert, again, this is where the federal rules are a good guide. Use an affidavit and a CV from the expert to help with the qualification. Okay, so my last topic here is appeals. Immigration court appeals are taken to the Board of Immigration Appeals and then to the relevant federal circuit. If you need to do that, there's no mailbox rule, so if you need to take an appeal to the Board of Immigration Appeals, it has to be received at the board by the 30th day. If you have a child client who can't afford to pay the fee for an appeal, a fee waiver is available. You need to separately enter your appearance at the BIA. You're not automatically the lawyer there just because you were below. There's a parallel practice manual that's excellent. And if you win at the Board of Immigration Appeals, the government cannot take an appeal to the circuit. So if you prevail at the BIA, you're done, and they can't rake you over the coals any further. So I think that's it for now, and thank you.